I'm Dr. Chambliss Harrod. I'm one of the spine surgeons at the Spine Center in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Today I'd like to talk to you about osteoporotic compression fractures. Really, they're one of the most common problems that we face as we grow older, which hopefully all of us do get older. And this day and age, it's become very common for as people live into their 80s, this problem is becoming much more prevalent. And what you have is, first off, understand a very common problem. Perhaps osteoporosis is one of, if not the most common, musculoskeletal problems that we have and that we have to deal with as orthopedic surgeons, and unfortunately, a lot of times, you as the patient. Now, compression fractures, what your problem is today, is just that. It's a break in the bone. Now, this is a model here to show you. This is the pelvis, and coming off the pelvis is the spine. The first part of the spine is the lumbar spine, and then right above that is the thoracic spine. And then lastly, the cervical spine is what connects our head to the remainder of our body. Now, the cervical spine is very rarely to be involved in having osteoporotic compression fractures. It's the thoracic and then the lumbar spine, which is where the majority of these problems happen. And if you're wondering why that happens, it's because these areas of the bone, unlike the bones in the neck, although they're larger, as we grow older, the inside of the bone is filled with what we call spongy bone or cancellous bone, not the hard bone that we can feel on the outside. So this shows you the internal architecture or framework, which looks okay here, but as soon as you look at it here, you can see how it's really spongy and that it's porous, hence the term osteoporosis or bone porous, spongy bone, essentially. And so this shows you what happens, and instead of having a nice, solid, square-like bone in the front, what happens is that it becomes weak and brittle, and then will suffer a crack, and it can tilt one way or the other and create a scoliosis locally, or it can more commonly create a kyphosis, where somebody begins to hump over. These type of fractures are the most common type of thoracolumbar fractures, and the most common and most prevalent problem for patients over the age, really, of 60 or 65. What do you do if you're diagnosed with one of these? Well, first, we want to get pain relief. So you may require some medicines in addition to an anti-inflammatory. You may require a little bit of medicine that may be a little bit stronger to help you with your pain. And typically, a brace is a good option for most people to start with. Most of the time, I'd say about 75% of the time, with 4 to 6 weeks of medicine, activity modification, and a brace, you're going to be fine. You're never going to need any procedure. Now, if a brace and medicine don't work, there is another option for you. And that's what I'm here to tell you about, which is a procedure called kyphoplasty. We can percutaneously, with a needle, insert it through your skin and gain access to your bones in a safe manner to be able to then inject cement or support. Now, the technical name of cement is called polymethyl methacrylate, or PMMA. But what it is something that's been around in orthopedics for probably about 50 years. It's what we use in most joint replacements. It's the same exact cement that is utilized in that area, and that's what the vast majority of these types of cement augmentation procedures are actually injecting in to make you feel better. Now, what we actually do in a kyphoplasty is first, we used to take it and we did this at the hospital. And sometimes we still do. It depends on how sick you are and what your risk factors are. Of course, we're still gonna send you to your primary care doctor to obtain a clearance and to stratify your risk. And once we can select the right spot for you, whether that's a hospital, a surgery center, or we even do it in the office. So, as we get older, one of the more common problems that we're starting to realize is that we don't really want to give people anesthesia or general anesthesia that really don't need it, because we don't want to put you at risk to have potentially difficulties with your memory and other adverse side effects that come with general anesthesia. So one thing that we can do is, now we've traditionally done these in the hospital with general anesthesia, and now what we're doing with these is that we're actually doing probably about 85 to 90% of these in the office setting, where we still have an anesthesiologist that will come. He can start an IV, and it's essentially monitoring you as if you're having the anesthesiologist, except you're not in the hospital. You're not getting general anesthesia. And he's giving you medicine similar to like getting a colonoscopy. Then you're comfortable, and we can position you such where we can bring an X-ray machine in, we can see your spine, we can identify the different landmarks of your spine. And then once we do that, then we can identify the proper placements to be able to perform this procedure. Now, once we then have you set up properly on the table with the X-ray machine, what we do is we actually anesthetize the skin with a local anesthetic that also will decrease the pain that you have immediately, as well as for the next few hours after the procedure. And then we'll stick needles in the proper placements into the bone. Once we have you in the proper position and verify the needle placements, we then will blow up a balloon. Now, what that balloon is kind of, if you zoom in here, you can see it. There's two balloons that get blown up, and what they do is that they actually create space inside the bone, and they're also taking the bone that's broken and elevating the end plate in most patients to try to restore your anatomy back to a normal square rather than being a triangle, because we don't want you to become somebody who begins to get more and more humped over time. That's a big problem that a lot of people are going to be worried about. So we want to prevent that. And so when it does that, the balloon actually increases the space and creates a void in addition to elevating the edges of the bone. Then we deflate the balloon, and we then will inject the cement slowly, controlled under fluoroscopy, where we're looking at it under the X-ray and we can see it in real time. And typically this is something that takes overall probably about 10, 15 minutes to do. And without having general anesthesia, typically patients then recover and typically go home within 30 minutes or so afterwards in a much more rapid fashion. Then you're asking, well, what can I expect after this type of procedure? Well, the great news is that typically I tell people, take it easy that day, and then tomorrow, after you've seen your primary care doctor, it's back to getting back to your normal routine. You've got work to do, you've got things to do. And this is what will allow you to throw the brace on the side and then allow you to get back to being you and living an active lifestyle and doing the things you want to do instead of going to the doctor's office. Let me tell you, back pain is probably the most common symptom for which people visit their doctor, or at least one of the top two or three. So you're not alone. Now, most of the time, you're going to be able to push through, typically take some over-the-counter medicines, do the things that you've done in the past, and be fine. However, if it lingers a little bit longer and you're not quite sure if there's something else going on, give us a call or go to visit our website. We'll be glad to see you any and every day.